We are in the house today with a very, very special guest. Oh, yes. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, the actor and comedian, Colin Sharpe.
With what? Eye of the Tiger. You know, that was Hulk Hogan's first entrance theme in WWF.
No way.
Yeah, and then he switched to Real American after that. But if you see the old matches, they edited it out because they don't want to pay for the publishing rights.
Well, that totally makes sense, right?
Yeah.
It's like Facebook always takes down music when I play it or put it up.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, Sony has, this is theirs. Support at the beginning of this show will be taking down.
Yeah.
Or blanked out.
Yeah.
So I'm going to set us up here, folks, for whoever's at home watching us. Thank you guys so much for joining this show. We're hanging on out with one of my buddies from Comedy Bar in Toronto. If you've ever been to Comedy Bar in Toronto on Sunday nights, they have this awesome show. It's called Sunday Night Live, and it's the Sketchersons, and these guys are awesome. I had been watching them for years upon years, coming back when I used to live there all the way to being out of the city. I would slide in, come watch the show, or maybe watch a double show, and then stick around to the end of the night, hang out with these guys. And these guys are amazing. And we're so lucky to have Colin here to join us from the Sketchersons. Colin, how's it going, buddy?
Unbelievable, man. Time of my life right now. No, thanks for having me, Trevor. I really appreciate it. And thanks for always coming to those shows. You've been a really nice guy. You bought us some drinks after the show. We appreciate your patronage at Sunday Night Live.
Ah, thanks. I appreciate that. It's so funny because I remember the first time ever coming to the show, somebody had mentioned it to me and I was just like, okay, I'm going to go and check out the show. And then when I watched it, I was like, oh my God, it's so much. It reminds me so much of Saturday Night Live. And I was such a huge fan of Saturday Night Live, all the sketches and just like, but this is like the next step up where, you know, if I remember correctly, there is some swearing in it, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Depending on how long. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's that quick feeling of not knowing what's going to happen next. And there's that shock value of like having a little bit of swearing in it once in a while, which is like, whoa.
Yeah.
So for any of the parents that are usually, you know, they don't get out that often because they're spending time with their kids, then they can come on out having an adult moment, watch some Sunday Night Live, have some like good, funny laughs and like,
yeah. So there is one week we had a baby in the audience and it was crying during some of the sketches and we couldn't believe it. Like, who would bring a baby to a show at Comedy Bar at 9:30 p.m. that goes to like 11 on a Sunday night? And then the next week there was a different baby also in the audience. So 2 weeks in a row there was a baby in the audience.
I love it. Did you guys utilize the baby in any of the comedy skits?
We did not. It's tough to do that with sketch comedy because it's pre-written. So if in improv, I'm sure we would have. So.
Is any of it improv when you guys are doing the Sunday night?
No. The odd time we might have an improviser host. And you might write a sketch that has like improv beats within a sketch of different like sections where they could improvise or ask the audience something. Or Sam Adams, she writes these sketches that she often does with hosts where it's two radio show hosts and then they get like a suggestion from the audience. And from that suggestion, like cast members go on the microphone and ask them questions for them to have to improvise an answer. But that's rare. For the most part, it's all 100% written brand new every week.
Nice. On Tuesdays, when I was a little guy, I used to come out to Second City. Second City had a Tuesday night drop-in and they did a lot of that where they go, okay, audience, name a location. And then you do the location and then you're like, and I love that stuff. And I took a look at some of the skits that I hadn't seen, but that you were in on YouTube. And so You're looking at me like you have no clue what I'm saying.
Yeah. Which sketches, sir?
There's a couple of sketches on, you know what? I'm gonna have to go back and see if I can find them and send them on over to you. But I believe it's for Sunday Night Live, because I came across, there is a page for Sunday Night Live with the Sketchersons. And I looked through all of them, and I think there's one or two of them of you in there. So now you're going to have to go back and take a look. It's on YouTube.
I'm going to jog my memory. Maybe I'll see some stuff I don't remember doing.
Well, you were saying now that you guys are going to start doing some shows on the internet that people can watch, right?
Well, we have been doing it pretty much since the early going of the pandemic. Actually, before Saturday Night Live did it, even. Like, not to say that they copied us, because they probably have no idea, but we started it pretty early. I don't know, we maybe done 6 or 7 shows, and I could be wrong about the amount, but yeah, we've been doing new shows every week. We've had some hosts. We've got Anessa Frantowski. She's hilarious, actually Second City alumni, and she's moved down to LA, but she's going to be doing the show this Sunday. And then we have Pat Thornton, who's a Sunday Night Live original, one of the guys who started it, and had a show called Hot Box on the Comedy Network. I don't know if you remember that. And then he was also on Sunnyside. He's one of the funniest guys in the country. He'll be hosting next Sunday.
Nice. So that will be, each Sunday, what time and where can we find it?
9 p.m. every Sunday it's a little bit earlier than our live show, which we do at 9:30. So it's at 9 p.m. every Sunday, streaming live on Facebook. You can go to our Sketchersons Sunday Night Live Facebook page. I believe it's under the Sketchersons. Or you can stream live on Comedy Bar's Twitch channel, which you can find on the Comedy Bar website, comedybar.com or CA, I'm assuming.
Sweet. Yeah. And so, did you used to do stand-up comedy before you got into sketches?
No, I did sketch. I did one stand-up comedy course at Second City in like 2014. Did that, and I did some shows after that, and it was pretty fun. But I guess I just wasn't compelled to keep doing it.
Yeah. Well, what got you into comedy?
I used to do. I had this amazing drama teacher in high school that she would get us to do like David Mamet plays or Harold Pinter, Edward Albee. And then there was this playwriting class that I really liked, and she was really encouraging. And then when I went to university, I took creative writing and then did some play festivals there. And once I finished university, I started doing improv at Second City, did their conservatory program, started a sketch troupe. So I've been doing comedy for like 10 years now.
Nice. So you're a veteran.
Yeah. Yeah. Time flies.
And so during the pandemic, you've been having plenty of time to relax and refill your creative juices. And you have put together a couple of sketches, or not sketches, but videos, like little short videos.
Yeah, they're video sketches, I would say. Yeah, they're little short videos I make with my brother, David Sharpe, who's also my roommate.
And your producer.
So, yeah. He'd give me
your producer.
Wants it. Yeah.
I love it. Should we toss one of those on right now?
Let's do it.
I hope you're sitting down, or better yet, laying down. Because when you hear what I want to do with you, you might just be swept off your feet. Girl, I wanna kiss you. If it's not too much, I wanna kiss you. Girl, I wanna hug you. A kiss is too bold, just wanna hug you. Girl, I wanna see you. No contact, just wanna see you. Girl, I wanna call you. Let's take it slow, just wanna call you. Girl, I wanna email you. If that goes well, maybe I'll call you. Girl, I wanna type an email, save it in drafts and sleep on it. then the next morning, read with fresh eyes and maybe press send. Girl, oh girl, oh girl, I think we live too close. Girl, oh girl, oh girl, I'll move to the other coast. Girl, oh girl, oh girl, we're moving much too fast. Oh yeah, we're moving too fast. Yeah, we're moving too fast.
We're moving too fast.
We've got a couple other ones, which you did, and I love them as well. And they pertain to the pandemic that's going on right now. Yeah. And totally makes sense. You made two of them.
Yeah.
Do you want to just talk about them afterwards? And
sure.
I'll toss one on.
Sure.
All right. So what gave you the inspiration for that particular one?
That one, I used to joke around. So me and Emily Richardson, who's also in the Sketchersons, are the head writers of the Sketchersons right now. And we used to joke around. I would sing these songs about like kissing, saying, girl, I want to kiss you. And then I just started like making it less and less as it went down to make it tamer and tamer. And so then I like wrote that song, and then I was like, what am I going to do with that song? And I was putting off doing it live because I was trying to figure out a way to make it work. And then I had the idea to do the video, and I had the idea for the ending, and I kind of sang like Michael Bolton, like a badly done verse of Michael Bolton singing. So I wanted to look like him, but I could only use what we had at my house, and we only had a wig. So then me and my brother figured maybe a ponytail, and we just tried to make myself look as bad as possible. Shoot stuff to fit what I was saying about.
That was perfect. I love the fact that you're lying, you wake up in bed with the outfit on.
Yes. Yeah. Right. Raring to go. Ready to go.
Classic. I'm not comparing, but back in the day, like I love that whole, that cheesy 80s kind of, because it has that cheesy 80s kind of feel, I think, right? Yeah. Like with the outfit and
early 90s, late 80s, yeah.
Yeah.
Getting ready for the day. Gonna meet some ladies today. I don't care if they're short or tall. Greedy me, I want them all. They're gonna beg me for some more the moment I walk out the door.
Oh yeah, the coronavirus.
Going back into my house. Gonna sit down on my couch. Gonna turn on the TV. Gonna watch Three's Company.
Oh, that was great. That was great. So, what inspired you to do that one?
Well,
I like that.
Skiron, yeah. I don't know if I'm a big wrestling fan, and there's this wrestler named Brian Pillman who's passed away, but he had some entrance theme in the World Championship Wrestling. Did you ever hear of that? WCW?
Yes.
And it was like the early 90s, and he had this song that was like, talking about women, and it's like, I like them young, I like them old, and then he's like, I like them big, I like them all. And it's like, I wanted to make a song like that.
Yeah.
I pictured myself getting ready and doing stuff like that. And then I was like, oh, and the pandemic had just started. I think I did that at like the end of March or early April. And I was like, oh, maybe I could walk outside and be like, oh crap. And I'll make the whole song about wanting to go see ladies. And so basically it was just an excuse to make a song like Brian Pillman's entrance theme. and my brother came up with the idea of like, I thought I could dance or something, but he was like, well, why don't I give you my guitar? My brother's a musician. And so he came up with that, and that really helped, I think so.
I loved it. That was really funny. And it's kind of like this journey, right? You're watching it and it's this journey and you're going on the journey with them. And then I love that the music stops and then you're like, whoa, and you can feel it. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh man.
Yeah.
We're not going out. It's just like my life right now. It's exact same thing in my life. I just started it. You know, like you can't leave, you know, I was single in the beginning of this pandemic and I'm like, well, how is this going to work out?
Yeah, I think if this thing goes on a couple of years, it's like, could get interesting.
totally, right? It'll be like Rapunzel, let down your hair.
Mm-hmm.
Like you'll be sneaking into.
Exactly. Yeah. People are going to start going nuts. If we get like a 3-month repeat or like even like a 3-week to a month, I think it's going to be like the summer of love all over again. 1967 all over again. Free love. But yeah
that totally makes sense. I'm signing up for free love,
although it might be the other way where people are super apprehensive and paranoid about getting the virus and so they don't, you know, want to go on dates, or they don't, but who knows. So probably a mix of both.
Yeah, a mix of both. Be half and half. You're talking about, you know, what the bar is going to look like once everything opens up. You know, is it going to be packed and everyone's like very social, or is it like going to stay empty for the first, 3 weeks, 4 weeks?
Who knows? They might have to like do it so they have like a cap of how many people go in at a time, and then they see how that works, see if there's a resurfacing of infections, and then put more people in. Who knows?
That totally makes sense.
Big question mark.
Yep. We'll have to start entertaining one person at a time and then three and then four. And imagine that you're at the comedy bar and they're like, okay, we've got 3 guests coming to watch you and you can only perform by yourself.
Well, right before the lockdown, like the last weekend, the Toronto Sketch Comedy Festival was on, which is every year, I think in March, I guess now. And they started placing restrictions and how many tickets could be sold, and there had to be like 6 feet in between. And my last show was an improv show on like Friday, March 13th or something like that. And like the guy produced it, Matt McCready, he capped it. It was fun, but it's like a lot of the energy of comedy is people being close together, you know, and laughter is infectious, so when you're more spread out, it's going to be more reserved, I think. But
and I do remember that over at Comedy Bar, they do have, it's like 2 sections, so they try and get everyone at the front. If it's not that busy, they close the curtain, so that's, we're right, intimate. And then if it's too much people, they open it up, fill up the back end, right?
Exactly.
Just a brilliant idea. And you're right, like having the people at the front definitely makes you feel a little bit more connected. You know, with the laughter and seeing how the bodies are moving, and you know, and so just remind me, Sunday nights there's a band.
Yes, the awesome band called the Hazard Pay. They're a great band, so they play before the show and then in between all the sketches. So one sketch ends, they start playing a song, and then they stop playing when the sketch starts. And they actually play after the show now too, and people will get up and do like live band karaoke impromptu. That started. Yeah, so that was a lot of fun. Me and Matt Nads took to singing together. We did Roadhouse Blues a few times and some Van Halen songs. It was fun. So yeah,
nice.
It's too bad that we were really cooking there at that thing and we're having some great shows. It's too bad that this happened, but I mean, it's pretty trivial compared to a lot of the other things that are going on. So
yeah, 100%. Once again, for anybody joining us out there right now, we're hanging out with Colin Sharpe, live and direct, actor, comedian. We're super lucky to have him in. You live in Toronto, right, Colin?
That's right, yeah.
So he's calling us from Toronto right now, and he's part of the Sunday Night Live with the Sketchersons at the Comedy Bar in Toronto, right on Bloor. It is definitely one of my favorite stomping grounds. I would come down there. even randomly when I had, I mean, Sunday was my go-to, but even randomly I would come on out on a Monday or a Tuesday or a Wednesday if I was just in the neighborhood and I wanted to enjoy some. And I know they usually have, I think it's like 130 shows a month.
I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah. Are you doing any other events there or just the Sundays right now?
You mean during the pandemic or in general before?
Well, definitely not right now, but in general.
Like on this page. Yeah, I would do the odd improv show or the odd sketch or solo sketch show, but mostly Sundays there.
Nice. And so let's talk about plans for the future. Okay. Is there anything in the making for you? Are you working on any, any projects right now?
Well, it's funny. The future is so uncertain right now. Right now, I'm just kind of taking it week to week, day to day. I'm always having ideas for different projects, like a screenplay or a TV pitch or a play. I've written a couple plays for recent Toronto Fringe festivals. But as far as consistently working on stuff, I'm pretty much just working on the stuff we're doing week to week and whatever comes my way. I'm trying not to get too ahead of myself right now because we don't know how things are going to be once this all ends.
Yeah. Are you, so this, that Sunday night Sketchersons thing that you guys are doing is, it's going to be online at 9 o'clock. Starting on Sundays, and so that's every week for you. Yes,
every week. We take the odd week off, maybe every 4 or 5 weeks, because the producer of the show and one of our one of the producers with Gary Ryder, Tom Hearn, who's in the cast, him and his husband do all the technical stuff. His husband like is doing the live, he's on a separate computer like putting up videos in between sketches. He's the technical director. So they live together and that forces them to have to be involved in every show. So we have to have, you know, so they don't just overwork themselves and die. we have a week off every now and then. Personally, I like to have a week off for the whole cast and not have to feel guilty about having a week off and not feel like they're missing out on something.
So yeah.
Pretty mostly every week, yeah, besides the odd one-off.
Well, I've definitely seen you many times performing there, and I realize how much work is put into the shows. So when you guys are working on a show, is it for the 7 days prior to you guys are working on the skits, or how does that work?
So we meet on Thursdays. We meet on Thursdays, and we bring sketches that we've written. Before the lockdown, we would meet at Comedy Barn Thursdays and read all our sketches, and the host would normally be there, and you'd pitch sketches to the host that you wrote for the host to be the star of, and then the host would leave, and then we'd read sketches that, you know, the host isn't in, just any sketch you wanted to write. Normally you have to write 2 sketches a week, and then the head writer, whether it's me or Emily, we alternate. The host tells us what they want to do, and then we pick the rest of the show and build a running order, and then we do the show on Sunday, and then you've got from Monday to Thursday to write new material for the following week's Sunday show.
Do you prefer more about the writing or more about the acting? Which one is more exciting to you?
Well, they're exciting in different ways. I really like writing because I like creating things. If I had to give up one, I would rather write. But I like the rush of live performing, and I often my writing can be specific to my performance style. So I like to perform my own stuff, but I also think I'm good at writing stuff for other people's voices as well. So, you know, I guess I like writing better, even though it can be a chore sometimes, but I usually have a list of like little bits of all like ideas on the go. So if I'm like running blank 1 week, I can refer to that and maybe be inspired that week. So
So does that mean you bring like a pad of paper with you on the daily, just in case you get an idea, you sketch it in, or do you put it in your phone?
In my phone, yeah. Or I'll record it on my voice recorder on my phone.
Nice.
Especially if there's like a voice I have, an idea I have for a character or something, so I don't forget.
Yeah. Nice. So for any actors out there that are like, let's say new actors that want to get, actors or entertainers that want to get into the business, is there any recommendations you would give them to help them get over their stage fright? Because it's obviously very scary going up on stage and being vulnerable, right?
Yeah.
So is there any techniques that you do that you could share with other people?
I don't think I have techniques. It just reps. It's just experience, you know? I remember taking classes at Second City 10 years ago and going up on, they would have student shows. And I remember the first student show I went up on stage for, I was just like so nervous. I was almost shaking. It went all right, but it just like, you still get nervous, but it's not like that kind of like nervous where it's like paralyzed or it's like, you know what I mean? So I think it's just like, I know it's hard, but if maybe take a class, whatever your focus is, whether it's improv or if you want to take an acting class at an acting school, or just go to a show, and there's jam shows. A jam show's like where you like anybody can go on stage, but you probably want to have some instruction in that early stage. So my technique advice would be just to try to force yourself to start, and then you'll do it more and more. And then, yeah, you'll get more used to it and you become more comfortable on stage.
Know your script, right? Know your script.
Yeah. Yeah. Although we, in the Sunday Night Live, we're learning everything the day of.
Oh, really?
We meet up at 1 p.m. on Sundays when we do the show live, and we come to Comedy Bar, we rehearse, and sometimes you'd have more lines than other weeks, but you're like, ooh, you just know your lines.
Yeah.
But
it has to be partly improv too, like when you mess up your lines, right? Because that happens and you just roll forward.
Yeah, and then you've got other people on stage that are all like experienced that can help you out of that, you know?
Yeah.
But that's sometimes some of the funner, more memorable moments is when you're on stage and someone screws up or you screw up and you find a way out of it, or just some silly disaster.
Definitely. So you said that you, 10 years ago, you used to go to Second City and you did one of the student shows. Was that, what days was that? Did you used to go to those?
Well, I took classes there on Tuesdays, I remember, and then they would have this show on Tuesday nights called Improv Night in Canada, and
I saw you there.
You did?
Yeah, because that's when I started going.
Oh, really? Huh.
Yeah.
The old John Candy Box Theater on Shoppers Drug Mart basement.
Yeah, exactly. Side door.
Wheel of Improv as well on the Mondays.
Wheel of Improv. Who was the young lady, the blonde?
Tasha Boomer.
Natasha, oh my God, she's so great.
So you were, yeah, she is. She's awesome. You were doing stuff there? Or?
Yeah, I was doing the Tuesday night drop-in and then the show afterwards.
Okay.
Wow. Yeah. Great. So that was about 10 years ago. So I think we must have crossed paths there several times.
Pretty much every week. I was pretty dedicated when I started. I would do the Monday show, Wheel of Improv, and Improv Night in Canada every Tuesday, and I'd also go to the old Bad Dog. There's a Bad Dog theater on Ossington and Bloor, but it used to be on the Danforth.
Yes, I remember that. Yeah,
every Thursday. So I do like three shows a week minimum, and then often Friday or Saturday on the weekend. So those early reps were important to make me comfortable on stage.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. You got to push yourself, get uncomfortable to get comfortable, and then it becomes second nature, I guess, right?
Because I'm sure you've experienced your DJ stuff and your live music and all that.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I always wanted to be a singer in a band. And that was my thing as a kid. I was like, I want to be like Elvis. You know what I mean? I think a lot of kids did. They wanted to be like Elvis, right?
This is awesome.
Or some sort of an entertainer. So I knew that my buddy was going on Tuesday to Second City, and he said, if you come, it'll help you get past your fear of entertaining. So I said, all right, cool. So I started going on Tuesdays, and it was fantastic. And and then it must have been maybe a few years after that I heard about the Comedy Bar, and then I just started going to the Comedy Bar and just enjoying all the shows. And I came across you guys, and I was just like, all right. And I was stuck. Nice. Whenever I was in Toronto on a Sunday, I'm like, this is, if I'm in Toronto on a Sunday doing a show, I stay late. And then
cool, man.
Yeah. Cause I'm 45 minutes out of town now. Right.
Yeah.
I just,
so it's hard to come in just to see a show.
So. Yeah. Like, as much as I love people and I love entertaining, being around so many people, like doing so many shows, and there has to be that time off where you're in a smaller town and it's less population. I like going to the grocery store and being like, hi, Molly, how are you? Oh, I'm good. You know, for a small town.
Do you have to line up when you go to the grocery store now? Like, you do? Yeah.
Yeah. The Walmart out here is like 20, 30 people deep outside. Must be the same.
Where are you living?
I'm out in, you know where Coburg is?
Yeah.
Sorry, Curtis, not Coburg. Oh, cool. Curtis, right at Town Line and Highway 2.
Okay. Well, I don't drive, so I don't know. But I know Coburg. I don't know Curtis.
So it's before Coburg.
Okay.
So I'm about 50 minutes east of Toronto. Which brings me to the next part of the video. We're about to put another video on, but I'm sure the viewers want to know two questions. A, are your eyes blue?
They're green.
They're green, but they're never blue. They're always green.
Maybe they appear blue, but as far as I know, they're green. Yeah.
Okay. And are you single?
Yes.
All right, you heard it here, folks. Single, corona-free?
As far as I know, yeah.
Corona-free. So we got another video here that you did, and this is one of my favorite videos that you put together, and I think it's great. And you put this one together, obviously, during the corona time.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pull it on up right now. And we're going to go live, and you guys get to enjoy it. Once again, for anybody who's joining us here, we're here with Colin Sharpe, actor, comedian. Super lucky to have him here on the show. And thank you guys so much for coming by and watching. And we're going to play this, and we're going to enjoy it. And it's going to be awesome.
Social distancing? You better keep your distance from me. I'm not anti-social. I'm just pro. Leave me the fuck alone. You know what pisses me off? Lockdowns, government restrictions, Bill Gates. Top reasons why I'm an asshole. Number one, you're a fucking idiot. Number two, see number one. When it comes to COVID-19, I'll keep drinking my Monster. You keep drinking the Kool-Aid. Fuck you.
Microbrewery near my place called Godspeed. Ooh. I'm not a big IPA guy, but that is pretty good. So.
They have some nice ones over at the Comedy Bar there, because I'm mostly like a Coors Light guy or a Bud Light guy. And so when I come in, they usually don't have it. So I have to get one of those ones on the tap.
Yeah.
And there's some names there that I've never heard. And I'm like, what's your lightest beer? Yeah. I try this one today. Okay. It's a blonde.
You're a lager guy. I like lagers too. But they've got some really tasty beers there. But the IPAs are often a little bit too bitter.
Everybody, Tuesday night.
Hold on 1 second. We got someone talking in the background here. And I don't even know where that's coming from. That was strange. Did you hear that?
I did hear that, yeah.
I don't even see anything.
What do we got? Here we go.
Oh, there it is. I had too many screens open from your video.
Oh.
Yeah.
Did it just go to the next video or something?
Yeah, it just went to the next one, yeah. So Colin.
Yes.
If anybody wants to be able to find you and book you for anything, because they're inspired by some of your work. Where can they find you?
I don't have a website, but you could check the Sketcherson's website and get a hold of me through them.
Okay, perfect. I'm actually just looking at the comment area, and you don't have to answer this, but one of our guests are asking how old you are. I guess they're she asked that after after I mentioned you were single.
I'm 34.
All right, you guys heard it. 34 years old, single, corona free. We're gonna start up a dating site here.
That is that now the bar now, the how low the bar is. Because I'm corona free, 34, I guess that's okay, and single.
Yeah, exactly.
Now I don't feel so bad about not owning a car.
You won't need it, right? It's like you can't even meet up with your date right now, anyways. It's just video vlogging with your, you know, with your date.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, it's a virtual world.
Yeah, it's a virtual world. Well, thank you once again for coming on the show, Colin. I appreciate that. Awesome having you out. Was there anything else you want to say to the world before we scoot out?
Go Leafs, go. We're going to win the cup one of these years.
And that's a great way to end it. I love it.
Yeah, but hopefully it doesn't happen. Hopefully if it does happen when there's no fans in the arena, it happens again soon, because that would be the most Leaf thing to happen. We finally win. We can't even celebrate together.
But, well, it's the no pressure, right?
Yeah, you don't have those fans in Boston in a game 7 getting in our heads.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I guess that's it. You know, if you have no one to pressure you, then you're like, you're out of your head. It's weird. You know, when I'm trying to sing, I still want to be a good singer. And so sometimes when I'm singing, if I know people are watching, I just get too nervous.
Yeah. I sound amazing in the shower.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what you guys should do. Bring a shower set up for your next sketch and make sure it has the right acoustics.
Yeah.
Bring it right up on stage.
Yeah, exactly. Or you're in karaoke and you've suddenly committed to way too high of a pitch and you can't sustain it throughout the whole song, but you're already too far into it. Have you ever been?
I love it. Can I tell you how many times I've done that?
Yeah.
Maroon 5, right?
Well, yeah. Why? I got to be pretty judicious about what I pick. It's got to be, I have a pretty limited range. I used to sing in a band myself, but... years ago, but more like a baritone, kind of like Jim Morrison or Ian Curtis from Joy Division style of singing. So that's my range.
So were you the lead singer?
Yeah.
Are we playing any instruments?
No, I can't play an instrument. No.
And me neither, don't worry, but I just picked up a 4-string ukulele just the beginning of this year. I'm like, I got to learn something. Come on, Trev.
Yeah. We start somewhere, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's it, right? All right. Well, thank you again. I'm going to let you go. You're awesome.
My pleasure, man. You too.
And hopefully this corona business is done and out of the way within the next 2 months for people like us to be able to get back into entertaining people live one-on-one. And in the meanwhile, keep doing what you're doing, because it's changing the world during this tough time. There's a lot of people that are going through a lot of stress, and there's people like you that are helping them decompress by making them laugh and smile. So Colin, thank you so much. We appreciate you a lot, brother.
Thank you, man.
Appreciate no problem. We'll see you soon. Hopefully sooner than later, and keep on keeping on, and please keep sending me some of your entertaining videos when you're done. And hasta luego.
Go Leafs.
Take care, brother.